Good afternoon. Hello. Good afternoon. Welcome once again to the latest Odyssey presentation. The Odyssey project was conceived in the depths of the pandemic to counter some of the enforced isolation and also to honor and learn about our individual members. We interview them on Zoom, collect pictures and memorabilia for display, and give them the stage for a question and answer period. It has come to be a pleasant and informative event for all. I was honored to be the interviewer for Rita Morris. She was one of the people who we on the Odyssey product thought, boy, I bet she would be interesting. Not that we heard rumors of a scarlet past or anything. No, we just liked her, and we wanted to hear her story. I don't know anybody that doesn't think Rita is one of the nicest people around. When you talk with Rita, you find that she is really listening to you. This Odyssey will give us a chance to really listen to her, and I think you will find it fascinating.
Because one introduction isn't enough for Rita. Good afternoon and welcome to today's Odyssey program featuring Rita Morris. Rita was interviewed by Joe Erhane in October of 2021 during the pandemic. Shortly after that, she wasn't sure if she wanted to share her interview, but here we are 2.5 years later. And I am so glad she had a change of heart. Rita is a beloved leader of our fellowship community. She is a woman who cares deeply about the people around her, but she doesn't take herself too seriously. I don't know about you, but when I'm around Rita, I find myself smiling more and laughing more. And I see some people shaking their heads here. She is, after all, a member of our fun community committee. I promise all of you that this will come shining through in her words and stories today. I asked Rita about a week ago if her kids would be watching today. She told me she hadn't told anyone about the program. But her daughter came to our Easter service last week and saw the Odyssey ad on the screen. Turns out people really do watch those ads. And so I'd like to offer a special welcome to Rita's children who are all watching online together today. We are so happy to have you with us. There'll be a question and answer period immediately after the video. And you children and anyone else who is watching online can submit questions via the YouTube comment area. There's also going to be a microphone here for anyone here who wants to ask her questions. And now, here's Rita.
My name is Rita Morris. I was born in Queens on Long Island, February 29th, 1940. For my whole life, living in Queens, my mother worked, which was unusual then. And, well, my father did too, of course. And we lived with my grandparents. And it was my mother who was the one that I find out later when you think about that, made things happen. She bought a house in Queens and brought her parents in, and her brothers, I understand, also before I was born. So all I can say is she was an organizer and a doer, and my dad was the social person who wanted you always to feel good. And my grandmother, I grew up, I guess, thinking my grandmother was my mother because I was home with her. I called her Mom. I guess I called my mother Mommy or Mother. I don't remember. She just made me feel as though I was okay in everything that I did. In fact, once I got, I got punished by my mother for picking flowers in someone's yard. I brought the flowers home to my grandmother as a gift. And, whoever it was came to my grandmother and said I stole her flowers. I was 6 years old or something. So my grandmother had to tell my mother about this incident. And so I was sent to bed without dinner. About stealing the flowers, and my grandmother snuck upstairs with ice cream, and she just said, "Don't say anything, and thank you for the flowers." And it really was a very calm and soothing place, and my grandfather very seldom spoke, ever, and he was wonderful. So I was very, very fortunate.
And what about brothers and sisters? Do you have any?
Yes. As a matter of fact, I had an older brother and a younger brother. They are both deceased. Growing up in a very small house in Queens, and yet I really feel that I didn't get to know my brothers well during that period. I actually went to, as I said, Catholic schools, and I went to a commercial school run by the Dominican nuns in high school. I had Notre Dame nuns in elementary school. They used five-sided rulers, you know, so you behaved yourself. I ended up going to a commercial school, which... you learn typing, secretarial, things like that. You don't learn science or math much or anything like that. And when I graduated, I actually graduated in 3.5 years, not because I was smart, but they pushed us through so that we could graduate in June and not the next January. You know, it used to be every 6 months. And my mother set me up for a job in IBM for the weekend. After I graduated, I was set up and sent to New York City to work for IBM. So, as a secretary, yes, and the people were very kind. But I didn't last there. I realized I wanted to go back to school. So I ended up arranging to take night classes so that I could get into St. John's University. I didn't have a background, so I ended up taking geometry in Jamaica Delahanty and languages. My father would drive me to a woman's house who would teach me French. I also took French at Columbia after work, and I pushed myself to do that, and then finally ended up leaving IBM and going to St. John's University. Yeah, and my dad was fabulous. He was there for me all the time. Yeah, my mother was a little upset because I wasn't giving her money after I graduated from I left IBM.
So you got a degree from St. John's?
No, I didn't. I stayed for 2 years, and it was wonderful. But then that's when I met Gentleman Jim.
Wow.
And he had gorgeous blue eyes. I started dating him. And then it was just like, it was $750 tuition. Can you believe?
Yeah.
We were going way back. And I started getting nervous that how was I going to pay that? I worked part-time while I was going to St. John's. So, you know, the boys in the family were encouraged to go to college. But that was a different time, as we know. And, you know, a girl many times in families was not. So I ended up quitting after 2 years. But I finally finished after I was 50.
So tell us about that. How did you restart? Or?
Oh, well, that was... These were, I look back and I say these were good decisions when I decided to quit IBM and, you know, after I got my night school stuff and was let into St. John's. And so after I was married, I ended up, of course, working part-time and, well, no, working at IBM again and stuff like that. And then after I was divorced, in 86, I guess. And believe me, it was, you know, it was a lot of good times. In 86, and I was working in Morristown. And I lived in Westfield and was working in Morristown. And in the building that is now our municipal building, which was Carteret Savings Bank. And they paid for your tuition. So I was like 50 and started going to the College of St. Elizabeth's. And so I would go there to night school on Saturdays, and that took a few years. So I finally graduated from College of St. Elizabeth's. Meanwhile, all of my children had graduated college already. I actually met him at his home. He was showing videos of his trip in Europe, and everyone else was bored, and I stuck around, and I was fascinated. So I guess he felt, you know, that I appreciated him, so that's how I met him. My brother was so excited because his nickname was Gentleman Jim. And he was the catch of the neighborhood. Go figure, I never even really dated. So that was all very lovely. Yeah, I have five children. Yeah. Yeah. And that was probably, I know my kids think I don't mean it, but that was the best job of my life. I was 21 when I got married. You know, we did that in those days. And I didn't know anything, you know, other than working and going to school a bit after high school. So I actually had the first three in less than 3 years, and then two more. So, you know, two more after that. So it was like five children in 6.5 years or something. And it was a different world then. Oldest was James, after both families, and Catherine, the second oldest, and Kevin, and Noreen, and Brian, yeah. And they're all out in the world, in spite of their mother doing very, very well.
Do you have any grandchildren?
Yeah, I have six grandchildren.
Ooh.
Out of five, you know, the five probably said, we're not doing that. But, so there are six grandchildren, and... four are in California. We've spoken about California, Joe. And I miss going there during COVID, of course. And then I have one in Missouri and one now in Pennsylvania. And let's see, three are in college. And
what are their names?
Oh, okay. There's, let's see, Culver is the oldest. He's in Missouri. He's 26, I believe. I didn't check my dates. And let's see. Sutter is probably 21, and Ryan is probably 20, and Sophia is 19, and Aspen is, I think, 18, and Cole is 16. Yeah. Yeah. Well, there's nothing better than grandchildren as far as I'm concerned. So they call me, this is what I requested. They called me Nana Rita. And then I add the last three parts to that, Nana Rita Cha Cha Cha. I love, as you know, reading poetry. I have only written probably one poem, so that does not count. But I love other people's poetry. I like poetry because it takes me to another place that is not so obvious in front of you. It helps me to identify with other feelings and thoughts that I have not brought to the front of my mind. And I just love any like historical, as you know, novels that have to do, though, with relationship. It's relationship that makes me pay attention to the information. Yeah.
So I assume you were Catholic?
Yes, 16 years of Catholic school by nuns, priests, and brothers. And I was Catholic through and through. I was afraid to die, that I would go to hell. So it was a constant battle. But I'm over that. I was definitely in the auspices of Catholic, you know, which was exhausting. It took me many years to climb out of it. I'm not downgrading people who follow the Catholic, you know, whatever, but it's not for me, so, yeah.
It was exhausting, you said.
Exhausting, mm-hmm. I can remember walking down my street in Queens Village on 109th Avenue, and I don't know why I remember this, but you know you have videos in your mind? I do, and that video is me walking down the street asking God to take me early before I do something bad. And I really meant it, yeah. So, you know, I'm over that. Thank you. While I was going to College of St. Elizabeth, I joined the Short Hill Ski Club. And Eleanor Mason taught tennis at Drew University. And she was part of the Short Hill Ski Club. And we're going back to the beginning of the 90s. And so Eleanor was giving tennis lessons at Drew. And it was part of the Short Hill Ski Club. And you know Eleanor, Joe. Yes. So you do what Eleanor says. So Eleanor's teaching me tennis, and she was like, Rita, the arm, you know, and God, she was making me shake, you know. So I would do, if you know Eleanor, you do what Eleanor says. And one night, she parked on campus, we couldn't, and she offered to drive me to my car. And it was only like 4 minutes, you know, to the car. But Eleanor wanted to know my whole life story in 4 minutes. So when I shared with her what I was doing, and it was positive and everything, and before I get out of the car, she said, you will meet me at the Morristown Unitarian Fellowship on Sunday. At probably then I got up early at 9 o'clock or something. And I was like, oh, you know. And so she was my teacher. What could I do? So I showed up. I never heard of Unitarian. I was a fallen away Catholic, but what's Unitarian? And I never left after that first day. Everyone was friendly. Eleanor was there. And the greed is there. Maybe it was you, Joe. Were so amazing. And I'm trying. Lee Houck was there. And Lee She never stood behind the welcome desk. She stood off to the side, and she greeted you as you came in the door, the same as you do. And she ended up taking me into her private, you know, life whenever she was entertaining, and so did Eleanor, and then so did Minda Chu, and so did Paul Mitchell, and they just invited me to everything, even when it was couples. And the services were like, I never really diagnosed what was going on. I just knew that I belonged there, and I felt good. You know, I wanted to open my mind up. It was just like, I don't know, I felt like a flower opening up or something. And so I've been there ever since. Yeah, I did head up, you know, the craft show and service auction, and I was on the board twice, and you know, now I'm just into spreading fun. My interest is to make people feel welcome so they can be who they are, you know, in any way I can think of.
What do you feel the fellowship has given to you?
Wow. I think it's given to me confidence to try so many different things. It's given me confidence to feel like I can lead in some things. I can be part of a team. And well, I consider the fellowship my second family, to tell you the truth. And so I just want the family to be doing well, and I just want to keep people smiling so that they can go forward and be more open to whatever's around them. Muff has become my life. Philosophy of life growing up was to do no harm. I was really afraid of mortal sin and all that kind of stuff, you know. But I think I evolved into the same idea of do no harm, but for different reasons, to let people be who they are, like with the children growing up. You know, I realized that they come from ages and ages of different people. And so I just didn't want to do harm. I just wanted to encourage them. And I wasn't so afraid then. Once I had children, I gave up the idea of me getting in trouble, you know, and I just wanted them to know how much they were loved and how they could, you know, be good citizens. I just love being with people, and I just love to see people smile. So, yeah. I think what I would probably like to say is to join a group, no matter what group it is, whatever your interest is, to get to know other people from the fellowship. I really feel that as a group of people, well, my philosophy is that no matter who I meet, or no matter who I talk to, or who I interact with, maybe it's part of that Catholic thing about Jesus being in part of everybody, maybe, but I really feel that I'm changed by everyone I meet, and then I feel responsible also that they might be changed by me. And so I just feel like everyone is a part of me, and I think the more people and things we get involved with, the bigger we become. The more we get to know each other, oh, the trite thing, the happier we'll be. So.
So in just a moment, we're going to have an opportunity for you to ask questions, and Rita will do her best to respond. If you are watching online, you can put your questions into that chat area on YouTube. So if that's what it's called, you guys know what to do. And if you're here in person, we'll have a Tom's got a mic that he'll bring around to you. And I think Rita wants to, why don't you come up, and we can start that process.
Hello. Now you can see why I waited 2.5 years. In watching the video, I kind of had forgotten, you know, what was on there. And I just remembered saying that when I got to IBM, I was 17 years old the first time I worked in the city with them. And I had said on that video that everyone was kind. And so I'm talking to all of you right now. I want you to be kind. And I think my five children might be on this YouTube, and to you, definitely be kind, okay? but actually, I'm only kidding. I just love being here, and I just love being with all of you. You're making me smile right now just by looking around, so be a little kind. Thank you. If anyone has a question.
So, because I'm holding the mic, I get to ask the first or make a comment. What I really love about your video is how who you think you are, that great outgoing person who's interested in others, is exactly how you come across to us. And it's just, we're so happy to have you here.
Tom, excuse me, but thank you, you and Donna, you forced me into this. And Hi. Joe, the oh. nudge.
Okay. Hi, I'm Jerry Weinstein, and Rita is one of my partners in crime in our fund ministry, as we like to call it. And when we talk about the work of the fellowship, let me just say one thing about Rita. When you work with her, and we work very hard together, it's not work, it's fun. But I had trouble keeping track of, you know, and this was done in 21. Can you tell us again how many grandchildren you have?
Jerry, I said be kind, okay? All right, let me think about this. I have 6 that I know of. You're a devil.
Hi, I'm Laura Alper. I don't speak in public, but I'm doing this for you, Rita. You're one of the most naturally funny people I have ever met, and one of the most resounding and indelible memories I have of you was the talent show from last year, where I was laughing, I was in stitches so hard that I cried.
Thank you, I love being laughed at.
Hi, I'm Kate Saw. So Rita, as you know, but I don't know if everybody else knows, you are the reason that I am a member here. You are the reason that I stayed here. So the first Sunday that I came, I think maybe in 2011, I sat somewhere in the rear, you know, just wanted to sort of scope things out. And along comes this woman, Rita, who sat right next to me. And after the service, of course, she engaged me in conversation, and I was like, oh, I really like this woman. So she said, you know, you really have to come at least 6 times before before you'll know if this is right for you. And I was like, oh, okay. And now, you know, Rita and I are very close friends, and we're neighbors too, and thank you. Love you.
Thank you for staying, Kate.
So we're still looking forward to our first question. Everybody's just had statements. Excuse me.
Hi, Kathy Cacavelli, and I want to tag on to something Jerry said. He said that, you know, when you work with Rita, you work hard and all of that stuff, and that's a comment, but you told me to be kind, so I'm not sure if I can ask you this question or not. So Rita likes to bribe people, and she owes me at least a case of cheap wine, which I have not seen until this day. Rita, when am I going to get the case of cheap wine?
You're right. I've promised you so much for all your hard work, and you're still smiling, so there's no wine.
I'm Diana Hart, and I'm also here because of Rita. I don't know if you remember, but you're the first person I met in the lobby. And also after service, came and spoke to me during coffee hour. And I've never looked back. If we could clone you, we'd need 10 more buildings to keep all the members in their seats. So thank you, Rita.
Diana, thank you.
There are a number of pictures that that are in the video of your cousins, I believe, that are called the Wild Women. Can you tell us a little bit more about them?
I can, because they don't know about this. yes, actually, my cousin had started this group, and she kept adding
adding people, and there's about 15 of us. And some are my cousins, my sister-in-law, well, let me just tell you this. In Morristown, I only know Unitarians. And so I travel with the wild women, and the word Unitarian never comes up when I'm with them. We call ourselves the Adirondack Wild Women, we get together quite often, and we dress up a lot and do silly things at our age. But our motto is, the higher we climb, the slower we go. So that's all I'm telling. That's it.
So Rita, I have to share this about Rita. You know, Rita, you're the person, everybody in here, you're the person that I will call whenever I want to mull something over, because you always make me, you validate what I say, you listen ever so deeply, and you make me feel like what I said was really important. And you help me make decisions about many things, and I really, really appreciate that. I want you to know that. When I see you, I feel very happy inside, because you just radiate happiness and confidence and love. And I just love you, Rita. But I do have a question for you. Unlike some other people who just made comments, I do have a question for you. So if you could go back in time and redo your life, what would you have done that you haven't accomplished up to this point?
If I look back in time, what would I have accomplished? Oh, I'd probably like to have developed a cure for polio. I would have probably liked to be out in space, but not too long, because I like people. Actually, what I probably would have done differently was to ask more questions, especially. You're just making me remember this. In growing up, I didn't ask questions of my parents or my grandparents. And so much of it is a mystery. And since now I'm pretty much the matriarch of my family, I have no one to ask of what's going on. But I think of like my grandmother and grandfather, and I really mean it when I said my grandfather really didn't speak much at all. And he had been an orphan, and I don't even know if he graduated from elementary school. And he was the most wonderful man. And I can't figure out how they met, because my grandmother was, with her sister, a detective in Nam's department store. So we are going way back. Ask questions. That would be my only advice before it's too late. Mm-hmm. But no more questions here.
So we have a couple questions online.
I'm in trouble.
Kevin wants to know which kid is her favorite.
What was that?
Kevin wants to know which child is your favorite.
Oh, God, here they go again. Oh, my God. Well, they all know each of them are my favorite, but of course we don't say that. They all think my oldest son is, because they think that's a fun joke, you know? Jim is her favorite. So let me just give you a quick one here. So out in California, and it's a birthday party for one of the grandchildren. And my sister-in-law and a friend of mine are there. And sure enough, the kids, one of them comes over in front of, you know, other people and says, oh, we know Jim is your favorite. And so my friend says, I think you're probably right. And when she's in her coffin, she's going to sit up and say, Jim is my favorite. So that's the end of the story. They're all my favorite, and they know that, so thank you.
Kat says she forgot the recipe for burnt bottoms.
Okay. Diana, you're a good cook. I know many people here are very good cooks. I cook for myself, and it's fine, but if people are around, I forget what I'm supposed to do. So whenever we always had with a family of five big Italian loaves, and, you know, we would put, you know, stuff in a little whatever on it and put it in the oven to feed them, keep them full. I can't tell you how many of those Italian breads ended up black. And my Jim, one of the favorites, he comes home for a surprise from college, and he comes and rings the front doorbell, and I was like, oh my God, you know, it was so exciting, and it was just him home, and so I ended up putting the breads in the oven. I think Jim, he might have said I burnt four loaves, because it was so. You know, you have to listen. And you can't cook and listen at the same time. Stop. That's enough, kids, okay?
Hi, Rita.
Hi.
All right, I'm going to stand up for this one.
Uh-oh.
Rita?
I'm going to sit down.
So, the orders of nuns and priests and brothers, and where are their mother houses? What were the orders of the priests and the nuns and the brothers? And where were their mother houses? Dominicans, where?
I don't know if...
Oh, well, we'll have to look them up. And for the talent show, would you like to sing with me the Alma Mater of St. Elizabeth's?
Oh.
Would you all like to hear that? I didn't realize we were alumni.
We are.
But we'll figure it out.
Do you want to sing it?
I will sing it with you. I've just looked up the words. I can't find the words, but we'll figure it out.
We'll figure it out another time, because
yes.
It's like black bottoms. There's nothing.
Black
with
bottoms.
The song.
I get it.
Thank you, Kathy.
In the video, I was intrigued because you said poetry was one of your favorite things. So on this day, in this moment, what would you say is one of your favorite poems?
Oh, actually, you have to realize this video was 2.5 years ago, and I used to remember things better then. But one of the favorites, I think, was when I was raising the children, and someone helped me with this. The one, what's his name? That speaks of your children are not your children. Yes, exactly. And I think I would try to read that a lot, which is very helpful when you're raising children, you know. And what's good about that poem, it just dawned on me because there's another side of me, is that you keep reading that poem and you can say, it's not my fault, you come from ages ago. You know? So, you're on your own. So. Anyway, so.
Hi, Rita.
Hi, Barbara.
It's Barbara Stasiak. And I wanna thank you for providing some fun during the pandemic and recently with one of your movies, many movie circles. And so I know you've got quite a few that you're a member of. So thinking back, are there any favorite scenes or movies that come to mind that you really enjoyed talking about with all of our friends?
You know, I think the last time that we had our movie group, I had said that we had already watched 43 movies, and I think others that have been going longer, could be 60 movies. And so, again, 2.5 years ago, I would remember them all. But I think the movie that affected me most for some reason that stays with me is one that Sandra Persichetti had recommended called The Other Son. And I have watched that twice, and especially right now, with what's going on in the world, It's a hopeful, very hopeful movie. I would recommend everyone to see it. The Other Son, yes. So, thank you.
Hi, Rita.
Hi, Frank.
You're obviously Irish. And I was wondering how you relate to Ireland, and have you been to Ireland?
Oh, well, actually, I brought my father to Ireland when he was probably my age, and he just fit right in. In fact, my daughter Catherine does all our ancestry. She's quite a guru. If anyone needs help, she's there. And she has researched everything that she could find about our Donnelly side. So it's quite fascinating. But one quick story about my dad. So I took him to Ireland, and we were in Dublin first. We went on, you know, a guided trip. And so I thought, I've got to take him to, you know, he played the piano, and he and my mother had gorgeous voices. I don't know what happened to me. But I took him to this, you know, Irish bar, and they were playing our music, you know, not theirs. So I had to request them to play Irish music. And he always wore a cap, you know, and he just fit right in. And he had quite a sense of humor, too, because I was like, oh, Dad, they're all gathering around. Everyone wants to talk to you. This is so wonderful. And then he turned and he said, I don't think they came around to talk to me, Rita. And I thought, what? You know? No. Anyway, he was a lot of fun, so thank you for asking. Quite a man. Mm-hmm. Are you going to get tired here?
Good exercise.
Please.
I think it was about 2016 when I was very new to the fellowship. And Rita called me. She was head of the auction fundraiser, and she asked if I'd help, and I said, oh, sure, I'd be happy. I don't know anything about it, but I'll be happy to work with you. The next day was Sunday, and I came to the fellowship, and people, I think, Donna, you were one of them, said to me, thank you for agreeing to head up the auction. I thought, this is a recruiting technique I'm not familiar with. Well, I worried over that a little bit, but we straightened it out, and I went on to be on her team for that event. And you were so wonderful to work with. And at the end of it all, you invited all of us to a thank you gathering with refreshments. And you were so sincere in thanking us that I learned about leadership from you. So thank you.
Do we have time for another question? John?
At least one.
Uh-oh.
I'm Marie. And I haven't known Rita that long. I've only been here since like 2016. But when I came in today, I thought I was her favorite. And that's how she makes people feel. I mean, I came, I gave her a hug. I'm like, she needs me to hug her before she goes on because I'm her favorite. Sorry, Kevin. Sorry, Jim.
Hi, Rita. It's Helene. One part of your life outside of the fellowship that I haven't heard you bring up that I didn't know if you wanted to talk about it is I've heard you talk a lot about your relatives in Texas, the family you take such you love going to visit them. I wonder, that's such a nice story, if you wanted to share a little bit about that.
Oh, sure, quickly, you'll be here all afternoon. So stop. Thank you for asking, Helene. I have a niece. I have several nieces. My brother had five children too, and they were all about the same age, you know, as mine, and we were in Huntington together. But anyway, one of my nieces, Eileen, ended up in Texas, and she is married to Liz, and in Texas, you know, that's not an easy thing. But they ended up adopting five children, and most of them were brought to them by social services. And one actually they took home from a hospital, a 15-month-old. And they're just so amazing. And then actually they had one of their own. however they do that. Anyway. but they have now a ranch, we call it the ranch, in Texas. And they have about 50 animals. And I just got notice this week there were many more lambs born, and this year they have horses and pigs. And these children help to take care of the animals. And both of these women are full-time workers. One's at home, and Eileen's a nurse. No one knows how they do it. And I get to visit them there. And, it's also absolutely beautiful. And these children love each other and love where they are. And one of them recently, I've had a lot of private conversations with them, and one of them recently said, "I never want to leave here, Aunt Rita. I don't want to ever leave here." So there's so much wonder and beauty going on in the world, and what people can do. And but I want everyone else to do it. it takes all of you, and I really love all of you. And this fellowship is so important to me. It truly is my second family. And you were here, you know, when I didn't even know that I needed you. So thank you, one and all.
I want to thank Alex for Alex and Gabor in the back for their technical expertise today, all of you for coming, and of course our guest of honor, Rita, for being brave and going through with it. So thank you all. Am I forgetting anything?
When is the next one?
Thank you for asking. We do not have a date for next one yet. There's so much going on in the next few months that we'll be sure to let you know, but it's not scheduled yet. Thank you.